First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. And as the last speaker of the conference, on behalf of all the speakers and all the participants, I'd like to thank the organizers, Professor Ko, Professor Peck, and Professor Shin, for hosting this wonderful conference. Let's give them a big hand. Okay. Today, I will talk about embeddability between writing and writing groups. Let's start from basic definitions. So, right angle writing groups. So, let gamma be a finite graph, finite, simple graph. Simple means there is no multiple edge and no multiple loop. And then we define a group G gamma, which is generated by the vertices with the relation that AB commutes if AB is non-edge. So, in fact, it's a opposite to usual convention. Usual convention is the edge corresponds to non-commutation. But here, our convention is that two vertices commute if they are non-edge. So it's opposite convention. And so, but I will keep this convention throughout whole the talk. So we will keep this opposite okay, so at some point the definition will be different from the papers, but I will keep this convention. And okay. So for example, I'll write an writing groups. If we have three vertices and there's no edge, then we have three generators. And those generators are commute each other. So this is isomorphic to free abelian group. And if we have complete graph, then we have no relation. So this is isomorphic to free group. And if we have this graph, then we can say that these two vertices correspond to Z2, and this one is Z, and we have pre-product. So this is isomorphic to Z2, pre-product Z. And basic fact, it's known that two graphs are isomorphic as graphs if and only if the writing arcing groups are isomorphic as groups. Isomorphic. And second, one graph is a full subgraph implies that G gamma 1, the first right-hand arching group G gamma 1 embeds in G gamma 2. This is a very easy to see. And here, full subgraph means that so the vertices of gamma 1 is a subset of the vertices of gamma 2, and two vertices of gamma 1 is joined by an edge if they are joined by an edge in gamma 2. For example, this graph is a full subgraph, this one, but this one is not a full subgraph of this one. Okay, we have two vertices here, then we should have the edges to be a full subgraph. Okay. Okay. And the question you are interested is this one. It's given by Chris Sagib Sapir. So they ask that given two graph, gamma 2, decide whether gamma 1 embed is C gamma 2. So given two graph, we want to decide whether one right-hand arcing group embeds into the other one. So we want some usually graph theoretic criterion for this embeddability. Okay, and the second question is somewhat related. So the question is there a small collection of graphs, say G, such that any right arcing group G gamma can be embedded into G lambda plus some lambda in G. Okay, so if we take this collection G as the set of all graphs, then it must hold. So we want some small collection. Okay. So let's call such G a universal family. Okay. So for the first question, the embeddability problem, one of the most important two is the extension graph introduced by Sang-Yun Kim and Thomas Kobolda. Hold on. R here?
No.
Okay. So here so as before, gamma is a finite graph. And from this gamma, we define extension graph. I write gamma E. So this is this is a graph so that the vertices is a set of all conjugate A to Z. Yeah, A is a vertice of gamma and G is a group. So here A powered by Z means G inverse AG. This conjugate. So we think about all the conjugate of generators. So it's usually infinite set, and the vertices are edges. It's the same as before. So two vertices A to Z and B to H is connected if AG and BG do not commute. Okay. So that's the edge convention is the same as before, and So I want to warn you that this is still, we are in Apache convention. Okay. Okay, so here the extension graph is usually an infinite graph, which is a locally infinite. So for each vertex, there are usually infinite many vertices joined to this vertex. And the theorem by these two people is that if gamma 1 is a full subgraph of gamma 2e, the extension graph of the second one, then G gamma 1 embeds G gamma 2. Okay. So it's very useful too when we want to prove some writing the arching group embeds into the second one. So let me give you an example. Let gamma be a graph like that. So there may be many edges here. But locally, look back here. And let's say the vertex, name the vertex as A and B. And think about and give another edge. Okay. And we want to consider the extension graph of gamma, which is infinite. So we want to consider some subgraph of extension graph of gamma E. So I want to think about who subgraph of gamma E on this for gamma minus AB union A to B. Okay. So what does this mean? So first we want to add a new vertex A to B. So this means B inverse AB. And we want to check whether this word, this element B inverse and B, AB commutes with the other vertices. And it's a basic, it's easy to see that this one does not commute with A, does not commute with B, does not commute with these vertices. So we should add edges here. But if we have a vertex like C is here, then this vertex there's no edge between this C with A and B. This means this C commutes with A and B. So C commutes with B inverse AB. So this one commutes with this one. So there's no edge between these vertices and other vertices. So these are all. And here we want to consider the subgraph on the vertices. We want to exclude A and B. So then we delete A and B. Then what we have is like that. Oh, sorry. What we have, okay, right. Then here, A to B is here. Okay. If you see these two graphs, you can see that this one is obtained from this one by contracting this edge. So if you contract this edge, we get this one. Okay. From this theorem, which proved, I think this theorem is before the invention of this technology. So at that time, it was a theorem. Now we have, it's just an example now. Anyway, what Sang-Yun Kim proved is that if gamma 1 is an edge contraction of gamma 2, then G 1, 1, 인베시, 7. Okay. So. So I think with this example, we can say that it's, the extension graph is quite useful in this kind of embeddability. And I want to give another example. Okay, this time, let's think about this graph, gamma 1. It looks like that, this. Let's put them A, B, C, D. There could be many edges here. And gamma 2 looks like so this graph is obtained from this one by splitting this vertex into two. Okay, so and name it like A, B, C, D1, D2. Okay, then I put it as a lemma because I want to use it later. So then in this picture, G comma 1 embeds E, G comma 2.
So edge contraction means a non-edge contraction? You contract a non-edge?
Here it's really edge contraction. So we have edge AB. We contract it to a new edge. Okay?
So this is not an example of that because it's a non-edge?
Yeah, it's a different one. Yeah. Okay. So the proof is like this, very simple. So we put, we write redraw gamma 2 like that. A, B, C. D1, D2, and put new edge, B to the D1, D2. This means D1, D2, B, D1 inverse, D2 inverse. Okay? Then this one does not commute with all the vertices here. Okay? And this one commutes with the other vertices. So in the extension graph of gamma 2, we add another vertex with B to the D1, D2. Then we have only these four, five new edges, this one. Then think about the subgraph, these vertices. Then it looks like this one. So this one is the same as this one. Okay? So this picture is a proof of this lemma. So in any graph, if you see this kind of vertex, the degree of one vertex connected to a degree three vertex, then you can split it with this one. So here in this part, it is some test graph. Okay.
Also, so you just realized gamma one is accurate. Right?
In this setup?
In this lemma.
Yeah?
You just realized gamma 1 is a contraction of gamma 2e.
No, because if there is an edge, we can contract the one here, but there is no edge here.
No, but the extension graph.
In extension graph, there is no edge here, so we cannot connect. Contract.
It's embedded in the
extension graph. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So this is embedded in extension graph, and we have to think about this subgraph. Okay. Okay. So then Kim and Kubota gave this conjecture called extension graph conjecture, which says that the converse of the compositive theorem, or let's call it an extension graph theorem, okay, this conjecture says the extension graph theorem converse of extension graph theorem holds. Okay. Usually it is very good to have some kind of conjecture, some bold conjecture, but this was too bold because some people gave some counter example, but still it holds from some classes, so quite useful. Anyway, so that conjecture was false. It's given by Kajal Swiss and Kajal Swiss and Duncan and Kaza Koff. So their example is like that. Gamma 1 is this one, gamma 2 is this one, then G gamma 1 embed G gamma 2, but gamma 1 doesn't embed gamma 2 E. So that is a counter example. But some people say that it holds for many cases, and some people say it holds for some cases. It depends on people. Anyway, so which class? First, gamma 2 bar, the target graph, gamma 2 bar is C3 free, and okay, this one. Here, C3 means the cycle graph on three vertices, and okay, C3 means that, so this C3 is not a full subgraph of gamma 2. Here, gamma 2 bar means complement graph, complement of gamma 2. This means that if we interchange energy, edge and non-edge, for example, if gamma is like that, then the complement is this one. So we change edge to non-edge, this complement. So this is the same as gamma 2 is this graph 3. And this one is same as G3 does not embed G gamma 2. So some people say that C3 Weidegger-Artin group on this kind of graph as a two-dimensional Weidegger-Artin group, because we don't have this three-dimensional thing inside Okay. And second example is gamma bar is gamma tuba is thin coder. Thin coder means E C for free and P for free. Yeah, C4 means cycle graph on four vertices. P4 means path graph on four vertices. Okay, if a graph do not have C4 and P4, we call that graph a thin caudal graph. And okay, so the same as gamma 2 is this one, 3 and P. Because the complement of this graph is looks like this one, so we have two things like this, and the complement of P4 is P4. Okay. In fact, in this case, we have some stronger result because of some result of drums, but I will just skip it. Okay. I will skip it. Okay. Now I will think about universal family. Okay, I think one important theorem also comes from these two people, Kim and Kobolda, that what they show is that all finite graph gamma exists a finite tree T such that G gamma embeds in GT. So that means that any right arching group embeds into the right arching group on trees. So in some sense, it suffices to think about right arching group on trees. Okay. So this means that if we take the collection of all finite trees, is universal in our language. Okay. And also, there is. Okay. So, and also we know that we can get reverse of contraction embed the original graph. So if tree have some vertices like with degree greater than 3, we can reverse contraction. So this is contraction. Then the right arching group on this graph embed into right arching group of this graph. So we can put here this one as a degree 3, degree 3 trees, or each vertice, we can add the condition that each edge has degree at most 3. Okay. Very much. The first, here the tree T is a subgraph of gamma tilde, the universal curve. So they gave a sort of a construction where the T is taken from some large portion of the universal curve. It's pretty big. in the sense that this tree has vertices. Number of vertices of this tree is like 2 to the m squared, where m is number of vertices of gamma. So in some sense, the number of vertices blow up in double expansion. So it's a very, very big tree. And in fact, and with An Kyung Lee and myself improve this region so that it just such tree T with number of vertices is like m times 2 to the m. So we decrease number of vertices from double exponential function to exponential function. And I think that it's a little bit pretty optimized, but it's difficult to prove that this is optimal. Anyway. Okay. So for the universal family, by Kim and Sang-yeon's result, we can think about, is it enough to think about trees? Then the question is, reduce further? Can we find some smaller classes? So the easiest challenge is a path graph. Paths are very, very simple. So think about path graphs. So Pn denotes path graph on n vertices. So the question is Pn universal? Okay. In fact, this is a question, asked by Sang-yeon Kim personally, but publicly, I was the first person to talk about this one. So some people say that it's my question, but in fact, it comes from Sang-yeon Kim. Anyway, okay. Then probably maybe, no. It's very difficult to embed some Rydek Artin groups into Rydek Artin groups on path graphs. And here is a example. Proposed by Takuya Katayama at Hiroshima University. And he say that if there is some graph which cannot be embedded into a Rydek Artin group on path graph, he said that this one must be the first graph we should think about. So let's give them this one. So let's give them that as Y, because it looks like Y. So this is a tree with only 1 degree 3 vertex, total 7 vertices. And this is the only new result I will talk about today. This, the Rydek Artin group on this graph embeds into Rydek Artin group on that graph with 22 vertices. Okay. Okay. In fact, the proof is not difficult. So I will prove this area. Anyway, before start the proof, let me give some remark. So, because this example does not give the counter example this case. So this case is still alive. And I think so. And then the next example should be giving more vertices on those legs. So let's write, that's like PQR be the graph with this the same shape. So here is PQR vertices. So total, so P plus Q plus R plus 1 vertices, and then conjecture. I'm not sure, but I'm almost sure I can safely make a conjecture. So then, if P, Q are large, then G, Y, P, Q are does not embed in G, P, N, O, N. In fact, I guess that maybe Y 2, 2, 3 is enough. Okay. But because, I mean, so this case is very simple, but because of the lack of the tools, it is very difficult to, for me, it was very difficult to prove that the right arching group, this one, cannot be embedded into right arching group or any path graph. So if you are interested, you can really try it. I really want some kind of algebraic tools or geometric group theory tool other than graph theoretical one. It will be very helpful. For example, think about the representation things. They do very well about this kind of thing. But representation theory, I'm not sure we can use representation theory on this kind of embeddability. Representation theory is very good at some isomorphism thing, but embeddability I'm not very well. Okay. And I think if you have some nice tool, if you have many vertices on here, and I think we can prove it. Okay. Let's go back to that theorem. Okay, comes from computation. And also, there is some, okay. In fact, I don't want to say much about that, but some people claim that extension graph theorem, if extension graph conjecture holds for this kind of trees. So, but it is issue, it's not difficult to prove that this kind of thing cannot be embedded into extension graph or path graph. I think so. But it conflicts with some other results, so I should double check. So I cannot say right now. But okay, and what we can use is some another graph, proposed by Kim and Kobolda, that click graph. So if one writer arching group embeds into the other writing the arching group, then the graph of this one should be subgraph of the extension graph of click graph of this graph. So we can further enlarge the graph, then it is embedded to that one. But that does not help. That graph is too general. We can use too many examples, and I'm not sure. And also, I tried to many. I tried to find the other constructions for embeddability, but all my ideas failed with this example. So that's so. I have a strong feeling that one cannot be embedded into writing the arching groups or path graphs. Okay. And the theorem is proved by this proposition. So let's say gamma 1 looks locally like this. So let's put A B, C, X. I say gamma 2 looks like so this time we put three vertices here A, B, C, X1, X2, X3. So you can imagine that we split this vertex into three vertices. And then put similar edges. Okay, then there is a local picture. The other part are same. And then G gamma 1 embed G gamma 2. V X we send to X1, X2, X3, and we send to V or V X. Okay. So we can locally change the left graph into right graph, then we have embedding of right arching groups. Okay, let's assume that proposition. Then proposition implies theorem. We are given this right arching group embeds in right arching group of this graph. By proposition. So here we have a degree 3 vertex. We change like this. So right arching group of this graph embeds into right arching group of this graph. And this one embeds into right arching group. So where do I erase? There was a lemma like that. If we have vertex like that, then we can change it like that one. Okay, so we have three things here. So we change that part into that part. Okay. This one is by lemma, previous lemma. Okay, then this is C chair. There are chair vertices. So cycle graph on chair vertices, and this one embeds in GN2. This one is given by the theorem. I already proved that PGPN embeds in 2GP2N or CN. PCN embeds in 2GP2N minus 2. So, okay, this is proof. Okay, the proportion is not hard to prove. It uses only very little thing about the word problem on writing arching groups. So I want to skip the proof. Okay. 그렇죠.